Gin Distillery in quite grand surroundings this time. Neil Atkinson.
Gorgeous.
Myself, Josh Sexton. And we're here to talk about some grand players. We spoke last week on Talking Reds about the awards for Virgil van Dijk and Alisson Becker, Neil. But there's more recognition for some of our great players now, with seven of them being named on the shortlist for the FIFA World 11. Andy Robertson being the first Scot as well. I know he's come out and said how honoured he is for that. But I think we've spoke about it in shows in the past, but between the two of us, you know, it's an honour to play for this Liverpool side, but it's also so much fun to play for this Liverpool side by the looks of it as well, and I think that the sort of rewards of that are showing now.
Absolutely, I think that that's very much the case, to be honest with you, Josh. You end up with the Andy Robertson thing, because it's been told so many times, it's almost become a little bit dull. This is someone who's playing at the very bottom level of Scottish football not so long ago, and he's ended up where he's ended up. But then that's the case for so many of these Liverpool players. They haven't really had straight line careers. Van Dijk has had setbacks in his career. Even someone like Virgil, Firmino comes over from Brazil in the first place. Mane does a stint at Salzburg. Salah fails at Chelsea, you know, by any stretch of the imagination. That's what happens. They've all had these journeys to reach this point, and I think that that's worth recognising. It's worth being proud of. You know, these are characters that have not been anointed as great players. The one who's arguably the closest, that's been Alexander-Arnold, our local hero, and he's got that sort of status that he was a hotly tipped young player. But even then, you know, back when there was a lot of chat about Alexander-Arnold will make his breakthrough at right back, I don't think it was, and he will be in the FIFA team of the year 4 or 5 years later, if that happens for him. I'm really entertained by the fact that none of the midfielders are on there. You know, it's a reminder that even though this stuff does try to recognise in a team context, the actual engine of this Liverpool side is still overlooked, and I understand why, because there's midfielders who come across much more attractive. You're able to point at numbers, you're able to point at spectacular goals, whereas that midfield still finds itself sort of overlooked because it is such a, it's such a unit that works as a team and works for a team. That Liverpool midfield powers a whole team, looks after a whole team, but it allows other players to shine, and so then other players get the headlines, get the attention, and they get the nominations.
Absolutely, and there's one player who you imagine would be probably the first name on that World 11 team sheet, which is Virgil van Dijk. He's odds on now for the Ballon d'Or 4-1 on with sort of most bookies ahead of Lionel Messi and Cristiano Ronaldo. And I know me and you have quite a few chats about Lionel Messi, how I've maybe said in passing in the past that I wouldn't swap any Liverpool player for Lionel Messi, but it's worth recognising, you know, that Messi's probably, you know, the greatest player of all time, certainly the greatest player in my lifetime, the greatest player I've ever seen live, having had the, you know, the niceness to do it at Nou Camp last year, but it didn't end up being that nice in the end with the sort of goals he scored, although when you flip it around at Anfield, it becomes a much more attractive picture. But it sort of shows, I think, Neil, that Messi and Ronaldo for so many years have been sort of, they've set their own bar, they've set a bar which is so high for themselves that now their achievements don't look as outstanding. You know, Messi scores 50 goals last season and he's coming towards the sort of twilight of his career now almost, and his achievements aren't being recognised in the same way they used to, because he used to be getting, you know, 60 goals a season, or, you know, you just regularly
winning the 50s. Champions League as well as winning the Liga. And I think if I'm Sadio Mane and Mo Salah, in all seriousness, I'm a bit like, well, what have we got to do? Because I think there's going to be a really strange thing. I think this award could be a little bit unpredictable across the next couple of years. And the reasons why is that unless Ronaldo and Messi end up with a trophy, along with performance that is 80-85% as good as it used to be for either of them. And I'm very much on record as thinking that Messi's the greatest player ever and Ronaldo is a once-in-a-generation player, but Messi is the greatest player ever by some distance, I'd say. But unless Messi and Ronaldo manage to cap 80%, 85% of what they used to be able to do with a trophy, then I think it may well go to other places. And one of the reasons why is Messi scored 50 goals, so you can't really give it to Sadio Mane. But Sadio Mane is integral to Liverpool winning the Champions League and getting 97 points. But you can't give it to Sergio Aguero, for instance, even though City do the domestic treble, because City don't do it on a European stage. And again, well, Messi's just better than him. So I think it wouldn't surprise me if Virgil wins it this year as a defender. It wouldn't surprise me if it goes to a defender next year. Let's imagine that Ronaldo has a quietish season. Juventus, though, win the Champions League and De Ligt's been brilliant. It wouldn't surprise me if De Ligt's name's now in the frame. A couple of big goalkeeper performances for someone could well lead to, because no one's going to, it's going to be very difficult for these people not to vote for an attacking player who isn't Lionel Messi. And also with the standards that Messi and Ronaldo, but especially Messi, set, it becomes really, really hard to say, well, we'll give it to Sadio Mane because he got 22 league goals. Yeah, Messi got 50. So you end up in this situation where Virgil's, if I say he's been the beneficiary of this, listen, he's been absolutely brilliant and he's been an integral part of Liverpool winning the Champions League. But, you know, And I think that he was undoubtedly really, really important for the first half, two-thirds of Liverpool's season. But who was Liverpool's most important player last season? You can genuinely make an argument that Sadio Mane, for instance, could win that. And Mo Salah's still scoring the goals and still doing the business. So, yeah, I think that Virgil will win it. I think it's deserved that a Liverpool player wins it. I think the thing that comes through in the technical report is Liverpool played the best football in Europe last season and therefore played the best football in the world. I think it's great for Virgil to win it. I think it's one, again, more than anything else, when Messi wins these awards, Messi does win it for Barcelona, but he also wins it for Messi. You know, he's so good, he's so astonishing. Virgil wins it, Virgil's good and he is astonishing, but it is also a team thing. He can only defend as a team, and Virgil's a massive part of that, not least because of how he organises them. That's part of it. So, yeah, I'm really pleased. I do want Virgil to win it. I think it'll be a great moment for Liverpool if Virgil wins it. But I think it's a great moment for Liverpool if Virgil wins it, because it makes clear that we're going to have the best, if not the top three, but I think the best, he's the best right now, but what I mean for 7 years, I think we're going to have the best centre-back on the planet.
I'm interested to ask you what you sort of think this means in a team context to Liverpool. I know you discussed this on our weekend show, which is our free weekend preview show, our free weekend preview podcast. That's out now on all sort of good podcast apps, Audio Boom, etc, etc.
And our app.
And our app as well, of course, download our app. but yeah, because you think about the players who've missed out and how maybe it will spur them on. You hope it would spur them on. You know, we've sort of seen the heated exchange, if you want to call them that, between Sadio Mane and Mo Salah at the weekend. It's clear these are lads who are pushing each other, but also for the lads who've now had that taste of success, are they going to want more for the team as well?
Yeah, I think it's all about for the team. I think that, you know, I think that for Virgil, he's gonna, if he wins the Ballon d'Or, he's going to feel fabulous about it. And it's going to feel, firstly, it's going to justify the big decision he made as to which club to sign for. And I think that from a Liverpool point of view, being able to say Virgil van Dijk won the Ballon d'Or playing for us, he could have gone to Manchester City, he could have gone to Chelsea, he could have gone to any of these clubs, he came to us, he won this thing, I think is, you know, it's, if Jurgen Klopp's ever dealing with a footballer who's wavering a little bit, it's a fantastic thing to be able to point at and suggest and say, this is what we do for people. But in the team context, if Liverpool get beat 1-0 by Tottenham, Virgil doesn't win it. Just doesn't win it. It's because, you know, you remember Cannavaro. Cannavaro won it because he captained that Italy side all the way to the World Cup, and a couple of the attacking players had a bit of a flat year. That's what you're looking at, and that's how this works. It is a team award. If it wasn't for the team, then we would not have, you know, then he would not be winning this. And I think that does spur them all on. But also, the other part of this is, I mentioned the midfield before, Jordan Henderson looks at his Champions League medal before he goes to bed. James Milner looks at his Champions League medal before he goes to bed. Gini Wijnaldum the same, Fabinho the same. They know they're the ones that matter. They're the ones, and they'll want to add to that this season with another Champions League medal, with a league winner's medal. And then, yeah, one of their mates might go back and might win the Ballon d'Or, but the ones that matter are the ones that lead to the shiny things. Everything else, it's lovely, and it's great for Liverpool. It is great for Liverpool. It's great for the individuals, and we should be proud of them. They're our boys. But for us, we all know what we want. It's that league, or it's that Champions League.
From some of the more glamorous individual awards to maybe one which is a slightly less glamorous, but recognition nonetheless for Harry Wilson, who's obviously out on loan at Bournemouth. He's been named their player of the month for August, forget which month we're in there, Neil. But yeah, obviously he scores a screamer against City. He's putting a few good performances, a few good goals for Bournemouth. But I know you've got a bit of a theory about this around Bournemouth.
Bournemouth have been crap. They've had a really bad month. They only beat Villa at home, and they came off, if I say second best in that game, they weren't second best. They kept Villa at arm's length and Villa struggled to break them down. But Villa were a newly promoted side. They went to Villa Park. They kept them at arm's length. They got an early goal. They got a penalty. Apart from that, you know, you look at the results. They find themselves in a situation where they drew with Sheffield United at home first day. All right, Sheffield United at home is not a battle of laughs, but they didn't create a great deal. They also got beaten by City. Okay, that happens to sides. But they've lost another game as well in there. And they find themselves, they didn't finish the season well, Bournemouth. Because of the personal achievements of Wilson and Fraser, it sort of got overlooked. They have a really inconsistent run of results the last 2-3 months of the season. They, for instance, knocked Brighton for 5, but get beat by Burnley, and get beat quite badly by Burnley, and they were coasting a little bit. They started last season really well. I think Bournemouth might be in a bit of trouble, and I think that this award, the lad's come in as a lone player. He's not started a couple of those games and he's ended up being player of the month. What that says to me is no one's playing very well. There's no other obvious candidates for this. There's clear inconsistency in selection. You know, Howe has been using Nathan Ake in midfield rather than at the back. And for me, I think he's a really good centre-back, Nathan Ake, and I wouldn't be moving him around to basically have him plug holes elsewhere where you've got concerns. I would be a little, I think that there's a couple of sides at the moment. So when you look at the numbers, when you look at the performances, are underperforming a bit more. And I think Bournemouth might be the bottom 10s Tottenham, where there's been bad performances for possibly the entire calendar year, masked by big results, by big wins, either big wins in scoreline or big wins of significance every now and again. And you can say, well, that's how what Howe's done in the past, and then suddenly there's a five-game run where Bournemouth win three and draw two. My thing is, there hasn't really been one of those runs since January. And I think that Harry Wilson may be in for a long year at Bournemouth, where he may well be you know, a bit of onus on him to produce a little bit of magic, because I do wonder whether or not, for the first time, and I've been a big fan of Bournemouth and I am a big fan of Howe, but sometimes things do go a little bit stale, and this might be the year that Bournemouth are genuinely dragged into it, not least because the other promoted sides, I think, do look quite handy. Not getting 50 points handy, but getting 30 points, 35 points handy, and maybe find themselves in a nice little place.
I'm interested to sort of get from you what it means for Harry Wilson's sort of career. This, I suppose, it does feel like his career in a microcosm to a certain extent. You know, his achievements at Derby almost become overshadowed by everything else that's going on at Derby with Frank Lampard and things. He's scoring all these great goals, and the Liverpool fans are looking on going, Harry Wilson looks good, why can't he get a game for Liverpool? And this sort of feels like now is his last loan spell where he has to impress. This is the Premier League loan spell that everyone wanted him to have, which is sort of just behind Liverpool's level. It feels like this is the season where he has to make that next step.
Yeah, I think that's really fair. I think that we'll find that one out from him. I think, in general, I still think that Liverpool will find him most useful if he goes to Bournemouth and performs to sell him on. I think that there was some stuff came through about the way Liverpool's transfer windows ended up working for them. And I think that, you know, that they've got some people off the wage bill and they've shifted some money on, and that might be with an eye on changes going into next season. And I think that Harry Wilson will be part of that, in that I think he's an asset. And they may well make a decision to involve and include that asset, but they may also make a decision with that asset to shift it on, not get him off the wage bill, because I'm sure he's not on a significant wage that's crippling Liverpool, but put themselves in a position where, for instance, he goes for 30, 35 million and Liverpool can recycle that money. I think the one to watch, I think a little bit more maybe around what he's doing on loan and coming back into the fold, could be Grewich. I think Grewich is a bit more in the balance. I think Liverpool may well decide to persevere with Grewich as a first team player, or may conclude that they'd actually quite like to cash in. And that could well depend on the business they want to do next summer. I think Wilson is almost best seen as, and I mean this with the greatest respect, to a footballer who I think is more than good enough to play for, I'd argue, to play for Leicester, to be quite honest with you, regularly. I think we could be looking at a footballer who, you know, who will be an asset to Liverpool, but maybe one which is all about the transfer market.
Absolutely, and there's loads more of this kind of thing on our tour player service. As we mentioned, the weekend that came out this morning, that is our free weekend preview show.
6 a.m.
6 a.m. it came out. There's lots of Neil Atkinson today, actually. He hosted the weekender. He's hosted a stat show as well, which is coming out on our tour player video service later on.
Best write it.
And there's an AFQ coming out later as well, which will be recorded.
Should we tell people they can buy this here?
Of course, yeah.
£20, Castle Street, at the Liverpool Gin Distillery. It is Liverpool vodka. Has the Liver Bird on, all the hits, the red, and it's actually got the club on the back. Do check it out. £20 from Castle Street. If you want to pop in, give them a knock and pick it up.
Yeah, you'll have to be drinking a couple of them on AFQ later, won't you?
And we'll see how it goes.
Download our app anyway, as Neil said earlier. If it's your first time downloading, you get 300 free tokens, which means you can listen to a few of our shows for free and get a bit of a flavour of what we're doing, and then hopefully you'll subscribe after that. But yeah, that's been it for Friday's Talking Reds.